Hello, I'm Sheila Swanson. Welcome to Microsoft MS-DOS 6.0 Introductory Skills. And this is MS-DOS 6.0 from the Microsoft Corporation, a powerful program designed to help you find, organize, and use files quickly and easily with powerful file management tools. Quickly format disks to prepare them for use, undelete files that you've deleted by accident, and work faster in a specially designed environment with convenient windows and pull-down menus listing ready-to-use DOS commands. These are just a few of the exciting features and capabilities of MS-DOS 6.0. By the end of this tape, you'll gain the key to unlocking this power. In just a short time, you'll learn what DOS is and how to use a command, use the DIR command, change drives, cancel commands, change directories, use a wildcard character, move and copy files, rename files, delete and undelete files, format disks, and use the MS-DOS shell. MS-DOS 6.0 is a powerful program, but once you get to know it, it can be easy and even fun to use. To begin with, you may be wondering, what is DOS, and why do I need to know it? DOS stands for Disk Operating System. A disk operating system is a program, a special set of instructions, that the computer uses to access files and run software applications, like word processing and spreadsheet software. Your computer must have an operating system like DOS to work. Without DOS, none of the other software applications would work. In fact, DOS manages every part of the computer. The keyboard, printer, monitor, disk drives, memory, and all other internal parts. To perform these tasks, DOS needs instructions. That's where you come in. There are two ways to give DOS instructions. One is through the DOS shell, the other is from the command line. With the DOS shell, commands are listed inside menus. You simply select the command you want from a menu. If you're like most people, you'll find the DOS shell environment to be very comfortable and easy to use. The other way to give DOS instructions is by typing them on the DOS command line. This tape starts with the DOS command line, introducing the most important functions, the ones you're likely to use every day. Later, we'll show you how to use the DOS shell. Right now, let's get started using the DOS command line. Think of DOS as a traffic cop that directs the flow of commands and information between the parts of your computer. As the computer user, you are the commander. DOS will carry out your commands, putting you in control of your computer. You may be surprised how quickly you are in control of your computer from the command line. All commands are entered in a similar way. To enter a command, all you do is type the command at the DOS prompt. You can use either upper or lowercase letters for typing a command. Then you press the Enter key. We'll begin by entering a command that lets us look at the files on our floppy disk. Later, we'll add switches to the command to use different command options. We've already turned our computer on. The DOS C prompt is displayed. Our command line is blank except for C:\ and a greater than sign. Your prompt may look slightly different, though almost all computers display a C prompt. To see the contents or directory of a disk, we use a command called DIR, which stands for directory, and a command parameter that tells the computer which disk drive to use. Parameters are additional instructions we add to our commands. Parameters add details to commands by identifying the object we want DOS to act on. For example, if we were commanding a dog, we would command the dog to fetch. An additional detail could be the newspaper. The newspaper would be the parameter. Together, we have a command and a parameter forming the command phrase, fetch the newspaper. When using parameters on the computer, the command is written first, followed by the parameter. Together, they form a command phrase. During this tape, we'll show you command phrases like this. The command is in yellow letters, parameters will be in blue. If the command phrase includes switches, they will appear at the end of the command phrase, following a slash. We want to see a directory of the files on our floppy disk in drive A. Our command is DIR. The parameter is the drive letter A, followed by a colon. Our complete command phrase is DIR space A colon. To begin, we first make sure that the floppy disk is in drive A. At the DOS prompt, we type DIR space A colon. Then we press Enter. The DIR command displays the names of all files on drive A. When we use the DIR command, the file names quickly move up the screen. This movement is called scrolling. The names will scroll until the end of the directory list. In a moment, you'll learn more about this directory list, including how to stop this scrolling. But first, we'll explain the screen. These are the files on our disk. The screen has columns for the file name, the extension, the size of the file, and the date and time it was created or last modified. File names can have up to 8 characters. File extensions, which can have up to 3 characters, are used to group files. For example, JAN for January files. File names and extensions are separated by a period when we type them. The period does not display in the directory list. Now we'll show you how to use command switches to modify the command action. A moment ago, when we used the directory command, the files scrolled by so fast we couldn't read all of them. We'll use a command switch for the directory command, slash P, which pauses at each full screen of files. The command phrase is DIR space A colon space slash P. That's a pretty long command to type. You'll be happy to know there's a time-saving key that will type most of it for you, the F3 key. On some computers, the F3 key is located on the top of the keyboard. On others, the F3 key is on the left side of the keyboard. The F stands for function. These function keys perform special functions. F3 is the command retyper. F3 remembers the last command entered and retypes the command at the DOS prompt. For example, to retype the last command we entered, we simply press F3. Now we can easily add the pause switch. First, we type a space, then a slash. The slash is on the lower right side of the keyboard, on the question mark key. The slash is used with a switch in command phrases. Then we type the letter P. The P stands for pause. Our command phrase is now complete. So we press Enter. We see one screen full of files, and the computer pauses. At the bottom of the screen, the computer says, press any key to continue. When we press a key, we see the next screen full of files. We would continue pressing as many times as necessary until the list is done and the DOS prompt is again displayed. You've now learned to enter the DIR command at the DOS prompt with a parameter and with a switch. However, you don't always need a parameter to tell the computer which drive to use. If you don't type a drive letter, the computer automatically uses the letter of the DOS prompt as a parameter. For example, our DOS prompt says C colon backslash greater than sign. As we mentioned earlier, the letter C tells us the computer is currently using drive C. The drive shown at the DOS prompt is called the current drive. We want the computer to use drive A instead of drive C, so we'll change our current drive to drive A. You should know that the current drive and current directory are also called the default drive and default directory. That's because if we don't type a drive letter or directory name, DOS will look to the current drive or directory by default. To get the computer to use a different drive by default, we'll change the current drive. We type the drive letter of the new drive we want and a colon. On our computer, we type A colon and press Enter. The DOS prompt shows that A is the current drive. Now we could display a directory list of drive A as we did before by typing DIR space A colon. But we no longer need to type the whole command phrase. Now when we use the DIR command, the computer will automatically default to the new current drive, drive A. To see a directory list of drive A, we type DIR with no parameter. Then we press Enter. We're shown the directories and files on the disk in drive A. Before we take a look at more ways to use the DIR command, we want to show you a feature of DOS that can help you if you have problems using a DOS command. When using DOS, you can cancel or break off a command whenever you want. All you do is hold down the control key labeled CTRL and tap the letter C for cancel. As an example, we'll cancel the DIR command. We type DIR and press Enter. Then we hold down the Control key and tap C. The command is immediately canceled. A caret sign followed by the letter C appears. The caret stands for the Control key. The C stands for cancel. The DOS prompt displays again. So far, we've used the directory command to look at the main directory on our disk. Now, we want to look at a subdirectory. Directories and subdirectories refer to places where we organize and keep files. The work we do and the programs we do it with are all saved as files on our computer. The more work we save on our computer, the more files we create. To find files quickly, we must keep them organized. That's where directories come in. Directories are like large folders where we can organize files. We can organize many files and subdirectories inside of a directory. Directories are used to manage files so that we can quickly find and use them. The directory structure on a disk is often referred to as the directory tree. The directory tree looks like an upside-down tree with branches stemming out from a central trunk. Like all trees, the directory tree starts with a root. The root directory is the main directory. From the root directory, the tree branches out to other subdirectories. Now we want to see files in a subdirectory. All we have to do is add or change parameters. To show you, we'll look at the files in the Office subdirectory on the disk drive A. We'll use the DIR command and a parameter. The parameter will be the name of the subdirectory we want to see. In this case, / office. The / shows that this is a subdirectory. The / and the / are not interchangeable. If a command does not work properly, check to see if you've used the / or / correctly. At the prompt, we type DIR space / office. We don't need a drive letter because the computer will default to the current drive, drive A. Then we press Enter. The directory list of the files in the Office subdirectory is displayed. At the top of the directory list, the screen tells us we are now looking at the files in A:// office, the Office subdirectory. Below this, we see some dots followed by DIR. These dots are DOS directory codes. The single dot stands for the directory we're looking at, in this case, Office. The double dots stand for the directory this branches from, in this case, the root. Below the dots, we see the list of files in the directory. We were able to see the directory list of the Office subdirectory by using the DIR command with a parameter. There is also a way to see the contents of a subdirectory without a parameter, and that's by changing the current directory location. When you're doing a lot of file management and file listing in the same subdirectory, you won't have to type the subdirectory name over and over if you change directory locations first. This saves you a lot of keystrokes. To change directory locations, we use a command called cd for change directory. The command phrase is cd and the name of the directory. In our case, the command phrase is cd space / office. We type this command at the prompt. Then we press Enter. The prompt changes to show that we have changed locations to the Office subdirectory. To see the directory listing of our current location, we type the DIR command, this time with no parameter. Then we press Enter. The DIR command defaults to the Office subdirectory on drive A, our current location, and we see the Office files. To change back to the root directory of our disk, we type cd space / The / by itself stands for the root. Then we press Enter. The DOS prompt shows that our current directory is now the root of drive A. Sometimes we want to display the directory listing of just one file. We can do this with the DIR command, using the file name as the parameter. We want to see a listing for a January sales file. The file name is sales, and the extension is Jan. To display the directory listing of just this file, the command phrase is DIR space sales period Jan. We usually say this is sales.jan. At the DOS prompt, we type DIR space sales.jan. When we press Enter, the directory listing for the file is displayed. But what if we want to display a directory listing for a group of files on a disk, all with the file name sales? They all have different extensions, but the common file name of sales. We can use the asterisk wildcard to view the directory listings on all these files at once. The asterisk, usually called a star, is a special character called a wild card. The star tells the computer to accept any character or group of characters. In this example, the computer interprets the wildcard star in sales.star to accept a file name of sales with any file extension. So, the command phrase to view directory listings for all files with the file name of sales and any extension is dir space sales.star. We'll use the default directory, the root directory of Drive A, so we don't need to type this in. We type the phrase at the DOS prompt and press Enter. The directory list for all files with the file name of sales and any file extension is displayed. Note that one of the sales files has no extension at all. The star wildcard also matches with no characters at all. We can also use the star wildcard to view directory listings for all files on the disk with the same file extension, regardless of file name. For example, let's look at the listings for all files with the extension of JAN, regardless of file name. The command phrase we want is dir space star dot JAN. We type the phrase at the DOS prompt and press Enter. A list of files, all with the file extension of JAN, is displayed. You've seen how to use DOS commands to view your files. In the next lesson, you'll learn to use DOS commands to work with files. In the last section, you learned how to display directory listings of files. Now, we're going to show you how to move and copy files. We want to move a customer list file from our floppy disk in Drive A to our hard drive, Drive C. We'll start by making Drive C our default drive. It's a good idea to make the location you're moving or copying to the default location. To make Drive C the default, at the prompt we type C colon, then we press Enter. Drive C is now our default drive. Next, we'll look at the directory for the A drive to see the listing for the file we want to move. We type dir space A colon, space slash P for pause, and press Enter. There's the file we want, 1993cust.list. The listing is paused, but we don't need to see the rest of the files. We cancel the command by holding Control and tapping C. The command is canceled and the prompt is displayed. Now we'll move the customer list file with the move command. In order to move a file, we need to tell the computer two things. One, what to move from, that is, the location and file name of the original file. Two, what to move to, that is, the location and, optionally, a new file name for the file. We said that a new file name was optional. If we don't specify a new file name, DOS automatically uses the original file name. To demonstrate, we'll copy the file memo.txt from our floppy disk in Drive A to the hard disk, Drive C. When we copy it, we want to give it the new name memo2.txt. Now let's move the 1993cust.list file. Before we begin, we need to check and make sure there isn't already a file with this name on our hard drive. When moving or copying a file, if a file with the same file name already exists on the destination disk, DOS will automatically erase the existing file and replace it with the moved or copied file. To check the directory of the hard disk for a file with this name, we type dir space 1993cust.lst and press Enter. We get the message, file not found, which tells us there is no existing file with this name on the root directory of Drive C. We can proceed with our move. We type move space a colon 1993cust.lst space C colon. We'll use the original file name, so we don't need to type a new one. We press Enter. A message shows that the file is moved. Now let's use the dir command to see the file on Drive C. We type dir and press Enter. We see the file 1993cust.list in the C directory. Let's also check the directory of A drive to make sure the file has been moved off that disk. We type dir space A colon space slash P and press Enter. The file is no longer on the disk in Drive A. We cancel the pause dir command with Control C. The file has been moved from the A drive to the C drive. The move command is just that simple to use. Sometimes you don't really want to move a file, however. You want to leave it where it is, but place a copy of it somewhere else. For instance, you may want to leave something on a floppy disk, but also have a copy of it on your hard disk. The command we use to make a copy of a file is the copy command. We'll demonstrate it now. Copying a file is like moving a file. There are two things we need to tell the computer. One, what to move from, that is, the location and file name of the original file. Two, what to move to, that is, the location and optionally a new file name for the file. As we said, a new file name is optional when you're copying to a different disk. However, if you are copying a file onto the same disk, you'll have to give it a new name. Duplicate file names on the same disk are not allowed. To demonstrate, we'll copy the file memo.txt from our floppy disk in drive A to the hard disk, drive C. When we copy it, we want to give it the new name, memo2.txt. We're certain there isn't already a file with this name on our hard drive, so we'll go ahead with our copying. The command phrase we want to use is copy space A colon memo.txt space memo2.txt. We don't need to specify a destination drive because the C drive is already our current drive. We type the command phrase, and press Enter. The computer copies the file and displays the message, one file copied. To check if the file really has been copied, we look for the new file name in the C directory. We type dir space memo2.txt and press Enter. The new file name is displayed. In the last procedure, you learned how to copy files. In this procedure, we'll show you how to rename a file. The file we moved from the floppy disk to our hard drive was named 1993cust.lst. We want to update the file for a new year, and we want to have a new name, 1994cust.lst. We'll use the rename command to give it this new name. The command phrase we want is rename old file name, new file name. We type the command phrase at the DOS prompt. Note that the command phrase doesn't include any drive letters. The renaming all takes place on our current drive, the C drive. We press Enter. Then we type DIR and press Enter to see the results. 1993cust.lst is no longer on the drive. The file is now named 1994cust.lst. You can also use the rename command to rename a group of files all at once. For example, we'd like to rename all the sales files on the disk in drive A to be called revenue files instead of sales files. We want to keep the same file extensions, however. We'll use the star wildcard. At the DOS prompt, we type rename space A colon sales dot star space revenue dot star. Then we press Enter. Again, we'll use the DIR command to check the results. When we try to display the sales files, we get the message file not found. When we try to display revenue files, we see the renamed files. The sales files have been renamed. You've now learned how to move, copy, and rename files. Sometimes, though, we want to delete files we no longer need. The delete command can erase one file, many files, or all files on a disk. But once a file is deleted, it may be gone forever, so you'll want to delete files with care. Always verify which file names you want to delete before deleting them. To demonstrate, we'll delete a file named letter 1 from the disk in drive A. The command phrase is DEL and the file name. To delete the letter 1 file, we type DEL space A colon letter 1 and press Enter. The file is deleted. If the file did not exist, the computer would display a file not found message when we tried to delete. We use the DIR command to check the file directory and verify that letter one has actually been deleted. The file is not found. It has been deleted. Sometimes we'll delete a file and then want it back again. With MS-DOS 6.0, we can undelete a file as long as that file name hasn't been used again or the spot on the disk where that file was saved hasn't been used for another file. We'll demonstrate now by undeleting the letter one file using the undelete command. The command phrase we want is undelete and the file name. We type undelete space A colon letter 1 and press enter. DOS displays the directory, file name, and other undelete information. The undelete messages indicate that there is one deleted file and that the file may be recovered. DOS lists the file name with a question mark as the first character. The question mark is another kind of wildcard symbol that stands for a single character. DOS asks if we want to undelete the file. We type the letter Y for yes. DOS now asks us to type the first character of the file name. We type the letter L. A message is displayed telling us the file has been successfully undeleted. We'll use the DIR command to see that our file definitely has been undeleted. The file is there. We've successfully undeleted it. In most cases, you'll be able to use this procedure to undelete an accidentally deleted file. But in some cases, the procedure may not be successful. So again, be very careful whenever you're deleting files. So far, we've shown you ways to work with files on a disk. But before we can even put files on a disk, the disk has to be formatted. The format command is used to prepare disks for storing data. Once the disk is formatted, the computer can put files on the disk and keep track of their location. Before we demonstrate formatting a disk, we must give you a special warning. Formatting a disk automatically erases anything that was on the disk. If you were to format your hard disk, you would erase all of the files, software, and data on it. This would be a disaster. Do not, repeat, do not format your hard disk. Only use the format command to format floppy disks. If you're formatting a floppy disk with any data on it, be certain the data isn't needed and can be erased. We'll now format a blank floppy disk in drive A. To format a disk, the command phrase is format space drive letter colon. Because you always want to be sure which disk you're formatting, you should always specify the drive letter in the format command. We want to format the disk in drive A, so our command phrase is format space A colon. We type the command and press enter. A message appears asking us to insert a new disk in drive A and to press enter when ready. We remove our practice disk and insert a blank disk in drive A. Then press enter again. Messages appear giving progress reports on the disk formatting. Formatting the disk can take a little time. Soon, our formatting is complete. We are prompted for a volume label, which is like a disk name that we store on the disk. We don't need one, so we press enter. We don't want to format another disk, so we type N and press enter. The DOS prompt is again displayed. Our disk is formatted. We'll now put our practice disk back in drive A. You've now learned many of the DOS commands for working with disks, directories, and files. With this understanding of DOS commands, you're well on your way to controlling your computer from the command line. In the next lesson, you'll learn about another way to give DOS instructions using the shell. As you've seen, DOS offers many powerful features to help you access and use data. In addition to the command line, another way to access DOS features is through the MS-DOS shell. The shell is a graphical interface program that surrounds DOS. This graphical interface lets you give instructions to DOS by using menus and images on the screen. You'll be glad to know that navigating in the DOS shell is easy. To start the DOS shell, we type DOS shell, all one word, at the prompt. Then we press Enter. In a moment, the MS-DOS shell screen appears, with a box showing us that the shell program is reading the files and directories on the hard disk. The box closes. We see that the shell contains several different areas. At the top of the screen is the title bar, which tells us that we are in the MS-DOS shell. Below the title bar is the menu bar, with the menu headings File, Options, View, Tree, and Help. Each of these menu headings can be opened to display a pull-down menu of DOS commands. We'll show you how to use these pull-down menus in a moment. Below the menu bar is the drive list. The drive list displays a list of the drives we have on our computer. The drive our computer is currently using, drive C, is highlighted in blue. Below the drive list, there are two boxes. The box on the left is the directory tree area. The directory tree area displays the directory tree of our current directory, which is now the root directory of drive C. Your drive C directory tree will look different. The box on the right is the file list area. This area displays files that are stored in the current directory, which is now the root directory of drive C. We can display the directory tree and the file list for any drive or directory we select. The large area near the bottom of the screen is the program area. This area displays a list of the programs and program groups which can be started from the shell. Currently, the main program group is displayed. The two final parts of the shell are the status bar at the bottom of the screen and the scroll bars on the right side of each shell area. The status bar displays shortcut keys and messages about the shell. The scroll bars can be used to move parts of any list into view when the whole list doesn't fit into an area. You've just seen the different areas of the DOS shell. In the DOS shell, you can use either the keyboard or the mouse to enter commands and perform tasks. With a mouse, most tasks are easy to perform. When we move the mouse, a mouse pointer moves on the screen. We can use this mouse pointer to select things on the screen and perform actions. For example, we can easily select or highlight any of the areas in the DOS shell using the mouse. Right now, the highlight shows drive C is selected. We'll use the mouse to select the file list area. To do so, we simply move the mouse pointer to the area we want, in this case, the file list. Then we click the left mouse button. The file list title is highlighted, and so is the file we clicked on or near. We always use the left mouse button when performing tasks in DOS. So when we say click, we mean click with the left mouse button. We use the same procedure to select each area. In addition to selecting shell areas, we can use the mouse to open shell menus. We'll start with the first menu heading, File. With a pointer in place on the File menu heading, we click once. The File menu is displayed. Each command listed here helps us work with files. The file commands include open, run, print, move, delete, and others. Notice that one of the commands, Create Directory, is a lighter shade. That means this command can't be accessed right now. We use the same procedure to open the other shell menus. The Options menu contains options for working with the shell. The View menu includes commands to change the view of the shell screen. Tree menu commands expand or collapse the directory tree. Finally, we click open the last menu, the Help menu. These commands are designed to help with questions about using the DOS shell. For now, we're finished with the Help menu. To close the menu, we can either click again on the menu heading or click outside of the menu. We click outside of the menu. When we do, the Help menu closes. You've seen how the DOS shell gives us convenient ways to use DOS commands. The DOS shell also helps us work with files and directories. Earlier, you learned how a disk is organized in a tree structure, with directories and subdirectories branching from the root. The DOS shell provides a visual display of the directory tree in the directory tree area. The directory tree on our computer currently displays directories from our computer's hard disk, the C drive. Above the directory tree area are drive icons. The highlight shows that drive C is our current drive. To change to drive A, we simply click on the drive A icon. The computer reads the disk information, and then the directory tree for the disk in drive A is displayed. At the top of the tree is a bracket, then A colon backslash. This is the root directory of drive A. Again, the root directory is the main directory of a drive. The root directory is always displayed at the top of the directory tree and is represented by a backslash symbol. The root directory of drive A is currently highlighted in the directory tree. The file list area shows the files in the highlighted directory. Under the root directory are directories that branch off from the root directory. Each bracket represents a directory. Notice that several brackets contain a plus sign. The plus sign means the directory contains subdirectories. We can easily display the subdirectories. This is called expanding the directory. We'll expand the accounts directory. We point to the plus sign in the bracket and click. The accounts directory is highlighted and expands, displaying its branches. We see two subdirectories named East and West. We can tell from the plus signs in the East and the West brackets that there are subdirectories in both the East and West directories. We also see that the accounts bracket now contains a minus sign. The minus sign means that all branches in that directory have been expanded. To collapse a directory, so its subdirectories are no longer displayed, we just click on the bracket with the minus sign. As we said, the file list area displays the files in the selected directory. To select a directory without expanding it, we just click on the directory name. We'll select the East directory. We click on its name. And the East directory files are displayed in the file list area. The file list heading displays the complete path name for the file list. A path name shows us the path from the root directory to a particular file or directory. The path name of the files in this directory is the drive letter and root directory, branching to the accounts directory, then branching to the East directory. We're done with our introduction to the DOS shell, so we'll exit now. The exit command is found on the file menu. We click on the file menu to open it. Then click on the exit command. The DOS shell closes and the command prompt is again displayed, showing our current directory. The DOS shell can make working with directories and files easy. Plus, you can execute just about any command from the DOS shell that you can from the command line, such as the move, copy, delete, and format commands using the shell menus and programs. With this understanding of the DOS shell, you can now access the powerful commands of DOS from either the shell menus or command line. The choice is yours. You've now finished this tape, Microsoft MS-DOS 6.0 Introductory Skills. In just a short time, you've learned what DOS is and how to use a command, use the DIR command, change drives, cancel commands, change directories, use a wildcard character, move and copy files, rename files, delete and undelete files, format disks, and use the DOS shell. Now you can put the power of Microsoft MS-DOS 6.0 to work for you.